All right, we're going to proceed with a discussion of the implications, the conceptual implications from quasi-geostrophic theory. And just to review, we found that the response term over here from the quasi-geostrophic omega equation, static stability, that's scaling vertical motion, vertical velocity over here, we'll talk about this in terms of W or dz dt, can be related to the forcing mechanisms of differential vorticity advection and thermal advection. Also from the G potential tendency equation over here, minus chi over here, when we're talking about height changes, can be related to forcing terms of vorticity advection and differential thermal advection. Let's start out by talking about the results from the quasi-geostrophic omega equation over here, where differential vorticity advection and thermal advection are playing a role in terms of influencing the vertical velocity. I want to focus first over here on sigma times W over here from the quasi-geostrophic omega equation. And again, we're thinking of omega, we're thinking of minus W, W minus omega. We're going to think here in terms of dz dt. We have the static stability term sigma, which is scaling the W over here. So let's consider the case with a shortwave trough. Downstream from the shortwave trough, we're having the presence of dCVA, a forcing term resulting in upward motion. That upward motion is going to be scaled by the static stability. So given forcing that is fixed, for instance, our differential vorticity advection and thermal advection sum is fixed. So for fixed forcing, our vertical motion response will be scaled by the static stability. In other words, if we have an increase in static stability, in this particular example, consider static stability increasing, then we know that the atmosphere is going to be a lot more resistant to vertical displacements, such that with a right-hand side here being held constant, and an increase in static stability, an increase in the resistance of the atmosphere to vertical motion, the response magnitude W here, magnitude of W, or the atmosphere's response in terms of producing vertical motion, will decrease because the right-hand side is being held constant over here from the quasi-geostrophic omega equation. On the other hand, if we were to lower the static stability, have less static stability in the background atmosphere, or more instability, we can think of it like that, then the atmosphere in that particular case will have less resistance to vertical motion, and therefore, in this particular case, to keep the right-hand side the same, with static stability decreasing, we'll have an increase in the vertical motion response for the case of lesser static stability. And so that's why static stability is so key to consider in terms of how the response will manifest owing to the same amount of forcing. And again, lower or less static stability is going to correspond to a greater vertical motion response here, W, whereas that vertical motion response will be muted for cases of higher static stability or greater static stability. All right, we're going to now apply our quasi-geostrophic omega equation to a couple of cases here, considering what the effects are from the forcing terms on vertical motion. Let's consider a mid-level shortwave trough over here, a couple of height contours here, shortwave trough here, and downstream of the shortwave trough, we're going to have our vort max here within the base of the trough. Flow is going to be moving across that vort max to promote cyclonic vorticity advection downstream from the shortwave trough, as we will have flow that is spreading from greater amounts of vertical vorticity to lesser amounts of vertical vorticity. We're going to assume that the cyclonic vorticity advection is going to be equivalent to the differential cyclonic vorticity advection. The assumption here is that vorticity advections in the lower part of the atmosphere are small compared to those in the mid and high levels, owing to the fact, number of factors, number one being the boundary layer. Frictional effects are going to have a tendency to decrease the background flow down low in the atmosphere. Advections are going to be lowered on the lower part of the atmosphere, such that differential cyclonic vorticity advection can be considered conceptually equivalent to cyclonic vorticity advection in this example. And with the dCVA over here, that corresponds to a positive forcing over here, in the quasi-geostrophic omega equation, and then if that forcing is positive, that corresponds to W being positive and upward motion downstream from shortwave troughs. Let's look upstream from the shortwave trough. We're going to be having lower amounts of vorticity spreading toward higher vorticity accompanying the shortwave trough, which corresponds to anticyclonic vorticity advection, or DAVA. The forcing term upstream will be negative, and therefore WdZdt is also going to be negative, and that refers to subsidence upstream and ascent downstream from the shortwave trough. All right, now let's apply this quasi-geostrophic omega equation to an example involving a front and consider the effects of forcing from thermal advection. We'll have our surface low positioned between shortwave trough and the ridge downstream, while a cold front that extends, trails southwestward from the surface low, and a warm front that arches to the northeast and east of the surface low. In the case of warm advection occurring to the north of the warm front over here, that's going to correspond to a positive thermal advection forcing over here. So forcing is going to be positive. Therefore, W is going to be positive, and that corresponds to upward motion. In this case, to the north of the warm front, where we have lift occurring in association with warm advection. And then behind the cold front, we'll have cold advection occurring. The forcing is going to be negative, and therefore W will be less than zero. We're going to have subsidence occurring in the cold advection regime behind the cold front. All right, so that's the application of the quasi-geostrophic omega equation to frontal systems, to ascent and subsidence related to shortwave trough. We're now going to apply the quasi-geostrophic omega equation to talking about vertical motion attendant to jet streaks. And let's consider a mid and high level jet streak over here associated with straight line flow and an embedded jet streak, zonally elongated along background westerly flow with this flow maximum over here. So again, talking about straight line flow in this example first, no curvature in the flow at all. And so any vorticity that is present is going to arise from cross-streamline flow variability. That's going to be that speed shear that's going to drive a vortmax over here on the cyclonic side of this jet streak, and the flow variability as we go to the south of that jet streak in this background westerly flow pattern is going to support a vorticity minimum over here on the anticyclonic side of this jet streak associated with this straight line flow pattern over here. So all our cross stream flow variability, that is the component going into generation of vertical vorticity. And then we know if we consider from a symmetry argument, we'll draw a line here, meridionally elongated line here, going downstream, zonally elongated line over here, going downstream from the vortmax driven by the speed shear across a jet streak. We're going to be having cyclonic vorticity advection or differential cyclonic vorticity advection, applying the same arguments that we used between the equivalence between CVA and DCVA downstream from this vortmax driven by speed shear across a jet streak within the left exit region of the jet streak. And then as we're in the left entrance region of the jet streak over here, we're going to have DAVA occurring associated with AVA related to lower vorticity flow approaching this vorticity maximum on the cyclonic shear side of this jet streak. Within the right entrance region of the jet streak over here, we're going to have higher values of vorticity approaching lower values of vorticity. That's going to be associated with DCVA as we're pulling in relatively higher amounts of vertical vorticity upstream. And then within the right exit region here of the jet streak, we're going to have DAVA occurring as we have flow spreading from relatively lower values of vertical vorticity towards higher values here in the right exit region where we have DAVA. So we'll have lift or atmospheric ascent over here within the left exit region. We will have lift occurring within the right entrance region of the jet streak associated with speed shear. We're going to have subsidence occurring in the right exit region over here with DVA, and we will have a subsidence occurring within the left entrance region over here of our jet streak associated with DAVA. Now over here, we assume that we don't have any curvature in the flow. Now let's see what happens. And again, everything here is going to be associated with all of these vertical motion fields are going to be associated with speed shear, what I'll call SS here, associated with that jet streak. Now let's see what happens when we include some curvature to the jet streak to look something like this for our jet streak. Well, let's go back to our four quadrant model over here. We're going to have, and we're going to use a subscript here referring to speed shear generated processes that result in these vertical motion fields. We're going to have using, we'll draw a trough axis over here, DCVA associated with speed shear. We're going to have DAVA associated with speed shear over here. DCVA here in the right entrance region associated with speed shear, and DAVA associated with speed shear here within the left entrance region. Each of these are providing, we have ascent here, substance here. All right, now that's associated with the effects of speed shear, but this is superimposed with the effects of curvature. If we consider curvature alone, which is what we did here for the arguments associated with this example, considered curvature alone. Here was curvature. Here we looked at speed shear. Now let's go back to considering curvature. We know that downstream from the shortwave trough, we're going to have DCVA anywhere associated with curvature. And upstream from the shortwave trough, we'll have DAVA everywhere associated with curvature. So the net effects are that on the cyclonic shear side of the jet streak, our DCVA and related ascent is going to be additive here. These are complementary here in the left exit region, as well as the left entrance region over here. But on the anticyclonic shear side of the jet streak, these are actually going to be offsetting each other. The effects of differential vorticity advection associated with speed shear versus curvature. And so in this particular case, if we were to have curvature dominate completely, then in that case, the DCVA in the right exit region of the jet streak is going to also be associated with DCVA in the left exit region of the jet streak over here. And suddenly our four quadrant model is dominated by DCVA here, east of the shortwave trough, or up or downstream from the shortwave trough, whereas upstream from the shortwave trough where curvature is dominant, the DAVA is going to be dominant. And we have ascent anywhere in the exit region of the jet streak where curvature is dominant, and subsidence anywhere upstream from the shortwave trough where we have the case that curvature is dominant. So we have to be considering both the effects of speed shear as well as curvature. They're both playing a role in influencing the vertical motion fields. And again, when curvature is dominant, we have ascent anywhere in the exit region, and we have subsidence anywhere in the entrance region of the jet streak, and then that will be offset in particular on the right side or the anticyclonic side of the jet streak owing to different signs here of forcing associated with differential vorticity advection.